You were live.
Okay, well, I'm live though. So are we running, Fred?
Yes.
Well, you're aware that there have been a few exception introduced as of June last year for text and data mining, which basically says that anyone who had lawful access to material, which basically means you've got a license in case of digital material, you own the book, the library, that folder. Anyone with lawful access to material who wants to do text and data mining for non-commercial purposes, and the debate we had was commercial, can do so without having to ask permission, without having to pay fees. And very important, this change in the law also said that if you have signed a contract which does not permit text and data mining, that clause in that contract can be ignored. That clause is invalid.
So,
They can do it, and that excluded clause in law is just ignored. It's just wiped from the agreement. Even if you signed it before, or even if you signed it today, it makes no difference. You can happily sign it because you don't need to pay attention to it.
That's interesting. So how can you say much?
Because they don't. I think it's actually.
People know about Harbury's, but I think people don't actually know what it means to
that crucial extra bit is no contractual override. It doesn't appear in an awful lot of copyright. An awful lot of copyright law says basically if you agree something which is not in your best interest, tough luck, that's your problem. In this particular exception, it protects you. And I think that's probably the reason why they're so much ignorant, because people just assume the contract takes priority.
Because that would be
my section,
if you're going to base the contract on so you would assume that if you then start a content mining or data mining activity, you would potentially
breach
the contract.
Yeah.
Then it becomes out of the function of the PR issue, whether
they want to see whether they're present or not. And to be fair, the publisher is probably assuming standard license for the UK, for Ireland, for France, etc. And the UK is virtually unique in having this special exception.
Yeah.
So why should they rewrite their contract if it's a standard contract?
Just for the UK.
Just for the UK.
So if the content that you're accessing is held elsewhere,
makes no difference.
So the public difference is the point of being. The
extra
data miners, they're not.
Yeah,
so if it's held on server in Australia, for example, it's actually a point of view.
Absolutely right. And it doesn't matter whether your license is with a US company, a French company, etc., etc., etc. The only worry I would have, actually, and those just occurred to me, if you have signed any contract, or if you signed any contract with a publisher, and it actually says it is under the law of the United States of America, then there might be a potential problem. There might be a problem.
So if a contract that you had signed predates
Harvard. Makes sense. The new law overrides whatever you agree. Basically, from the 1st of June, automatically, all previously agreed contracts, that clause gets wiped.
So, as was the first meeting due to Harvey's in the UK?
Yes.
If you are, it's legal to.
It doesn't matter when you sign the contract, how long the contract is for, etc.
That's what you're doing.
Yeah,
it's
interesting. So, if you does it prohibit any
type of
content mining? Do they decline?
The exception is actually quite badly worded in the sense that it says for text and data mining. It doesn't define what text and data mining.
Yeah. So does it take it to an individual basis?
It could be a group basis. It could be as long as it's for a non-commercial purpose.
So what happens if you've automated it and you're downloading, because we tend to know when people are, you're notified when people sometimes are trying to harvest a huge amount of data,
usually
because they're trying to get around, they're actually behaving illegal. So we can tend to be notified that potentially people.
When you say you're notified, is that by the publisher? Yeah.
Because it triggers something. Someone's.
Yeah, no doubt. So the message you get is, you've had this much downloads. Up to who the individual was or what the IP.
We did
an IP, like, downloaded 5,000 items on the 4th of January. Please investigate. Is that essentially what you get?
Yeah. Basically,
right.
Or you can be switched off.
You can be switched off, fine.
So would that be liable to happen if you were doing a post out?
Well, if they attempted to switch you off because of large scale downloading when it was in fact permitted in UK law, you would have grounds for serious complaint against the publisher.
I mean, it tends to be potentially
up. Yeah, well, sure, I guess sorted out, yeah.
Yes, I mean, I've been cut off more than once by publishers for what I consider to be completely legal activity. Normally, when this happens, you get a message that says, you must contact a senior person in the institution and show that you have reason to be reconnected or whatever. It's arbitrary and it's immediate.
So what do? You ring up the person?
Or email the person, yes.
Yeah.
I would email the live them.
Yeah.
You know, I might email Yvonne. Lots of people would know who to email, and so forth. And it comes out of the blue.
Yeah.
There's normally nothing to say, are you aware that you are downloading more than.
Right, so you don't get any sort of advance warning in that sort of sense. It simply says, you've been a naughty boy, we've switched you off, don't talk to somebody.
Don't talk to somebody.
Yeah.
Yes, indeed.
Yeah.
And so that's happened two or three times.
Two or three.
Right. Well, you may well, if word gets out, and word should get out, you'll probably get more of these requests, and you need to investigate. And there is a sort of duty on you to make sure it is for a non-commercial purpose that they're doing.
So how did you find that
commercial purpose? That's an issue.
Because say you're building up a data set potentially be used as a way of something that publishers are going to be
providing. That is an arguable point to be had. But where it's straightforwardly for what is normally called academic research, there shouldn't be a problem. Certainly is a problem if person who is doing the downloading either is being paid to do it, you know, has got a deal with an external company that says, can you do us a favour, we want to we'll pay you £5,000 if you analyse this collection of data, that's clearly commercial, or indeed it's been collected and as you say, is the intention of creating some competitive product.
Well, Jenny and Charles have written an article for Gist called Responsible ContentMine.
Yes, something like that.
Yes.
Non-irresponsible content.
Responsible content. And the idea there was for us to anticipate what would be reasonable to do.
Yeah.
And to put it in front of people so that if there was no objection to this, people following this would at least know that they were in the rapture book. So there are about four different reasons that publishers have advanced as to why text and data mining will be injurious to their activities. So the first is that it will put an excessive load on their servers. Now, you try and counter that sort of thing by showing what the load from responsible text or data mining will be.
And just interrupt you, the new exception to copyright does give the publishers or the rights owners a little bit of leeway because it says nothing done by the text of data mining should have a deleterious effect on the performance of...
Yeah, so say you were downloading from massive data set, yeah, you were slowing down the speed to
it. If you were slowing things down or causing it to fall over, then they have justification in saying stop it.
That seems reasonable.
Yeah, oh, I don't know about their interpretation of it, which I don't find reasonable, where certain companies are saying, well, even if you take, you know, 100 of our items, that's going to knock our system over, and which is just nonsense.
What about the institution? If they're in a position of saying, like, situation management, they're actually saying that about some of their systems, it's 90% of the same data, is that an institution issue?
That's for the institution to decide, and certainly not the publisher's business. That's an interesting question. If that were the case, and if you had researchers who were doing TDM and were thereby spoiling the service for other users, then that's internal politics.
Yeah. Is it fair to say that at this juncture, because it helps the early assessment effects, the 1st of April, it's going to be 6 months to for the waters to settle, but is it reasonable, and reasonable is a very realistic one, is it reasonable to say that we're still in uncharted waters?
Indeed, yeah, absolutely.
It's also fair to say that relatively few publishers have been proactive in making positive offers as to how this should be done. Most publishers have remained pretty silent. One or two have suggested that there are different ways of looking at it, and the publishers in general, through SDM publishers, have fought a political campaign in Europe for this to be done through the licenses of the publishers and the APIs of the publishers.
Set up of that, an exception.
If the publisher wants, say, their user base with an API, can they actually...
They can't insist on you.
Exactly.
It may well be a perfectly good API and may well want to take it up, but they can't say, you must use
it. You must use that, so we're allowed to use ContentMine.
So APIs are both positive and negative aspects. The positive aspect of APIs is that they are specifically engineered,
of course,
to allow machines to make large-scale requests and to have relatively efficient use of resources. The negative ones are that they often require you to have specific permission to use them, even if it's an automatic permission. In other words, you cannot use this unless you make a request. Secondly, that usually identifies you, so that you're known to the provider. And thirdly, that they may be able to extract usage data and so on from people with or without their permission.
And of course, they may well impose conditions like you can only take so much per day or whatever.
So what if a publisher does not create the exemptions that say a publisher sees some test content?
Yeah.
And although the person who's doing it is doing it with no commercial basis in mind, the publisher can see commercial opportunity there with potentially stopping them having revenue and demand.
That's an interesting question. I would personally argue that that's not a sound basis for complaining. This is the problem with this commercial versus non-commercial. The general approach the courts have taken to that is, if it is clearly commercial at the time that the stuff was done, so for example, let's just say a publisher is already offering something and is worried that what this other person is doing, it might be competitive, then they might have a case. But if they don't have a service, and if the person is saying, I'm just doing it for research purposes, non-commercial, but I don't think they have a case.
It's potentially a situation where by ContentMine activity you're doing, you're alerting, because of the type of thing you're looking at, you're alerting the data set by providing the data set to
That could well be. Oh, what a good idea. Downloading that particular subject area and creating something out of it. But that I think is too tenuous a link for them to complain.
There is an additional thing, which is some publishers create databases.
Yes.
Many of them by the sweat of their brow, to use a good phrase. And that it may be that text and data mining is a more efficient way of creating data in this area, and that they may regard this as illegitimate or challenging their position in the marketplace. But to do so would imply that they had an effective monopoly and status on innovation.
Yeah.
And that might be.
I mean, I don't think courts would be sympathetic to that sort of argument, but the truth is, if the case ever came up.
I just think of us sort of the reverse parallel, flipping it over, you know, from our perspective to that of the publishers and companies. That if you take, for example, like the Elsevier / Mendeley, who, regardless of the argues, they text and data mine for commercial purposes.
I do.
But we
do. That's true. Yeah.
So the power is still very much in the favour of publishers.
There's no question that the power.
Sorry to my Elsevier.
No, the Mendeley friends. But the publishers. Their argument would be, well, nobody's challenged this in court. Now, the problem is that the people who are affected by that are individual authors in many cases. Sometimes it's rival publishers. So if you move up the whole literature and transform it in some way, then your rival publishers might decide to sue you. And in fact, it surprises me that in some of these, the publishers haven't. But if you say, okay, well, I've taken an author's material, that author is very unlikely to have the will and the power and the ability to see your legal publisher and to get any rights back.
But there is the reputational issue, which came up in this morning's discussion. It wouldn't look good if a publisher was seen to be squashing an individual or a small group of scholars and thereby, you know, stopping the promotions. They've got their own reputation to think, you think of as well. And that is quite a powerful weapon at the end of the day.
Absolutely.
And although, as we had this morning, motivation doesn't affect the absoluteness of the law, in many cases the motivation here is not.
It's altruistic. Yeah.
It's altruistic. It's looking for advances in human health, or better science, or new materials, or climate change, or whatever it might be.
Well,
that's because
they count as a defence, isn't it?
Yeah. Well, you know, this came up this morning. Yeah, it doesn't count as a defence, but may well reduce any penalty.
In real terms it does, but in legal terms it doesn't.
Yeah. Yeah.
Not in the eyes of our
lawyer. I mean, we did talk about this this morning, the idea that if anybody has a complaint to make, there should be a notice and takedown procedure by the text and data mining group, whoever is doing the work, to say, if you've got a problem, let us know and we will, you know, engage with you.
So what about the law in different jurisdictions? What about the law in
the US? The law in the US is really woolly because it's fair use, and fair use is so vaguely termed that it could well be that a lot of text to data mining activities are okay under fair use, but it is ambiguous, whereas in the UK it's very clear that we have consumption. And getting on to Europe, the UK is currently one of only two countries which has this explicit exception, the other one being Japan. But the EU is now, or a member of the European Parliament, is now talking about introducing a whole raft of changes in the law, EU-wide, in copyright, and one of the proposals is about an explicit exception to text and data mining. Over the years before anything happens, because we've got through all the EU procedures, and indeed they will not happen because publishers are very unhappy and already not being against it. But it is possible that maybe in 5 years' time, if there'll be an EU-wide exception.
So taking it further, what if
publishers are only people who
are
text and data
mining?
Yeah. And that should
put barriers in the way, so
actually
put obstacles in the way
of
people who are actually doing it.
But the obstacle was to deliberately slow the whole system down. there is already in UK law a provision in the Copyright Act which says that if somebody does something to block your ability to do something which is legal, it's under an exception to copyright law, you can make a complaint to the Secretary of State. And you have to send the lead, you've got to fill out a form and say, this person is stopping me, or this company probably, is stopping me from doing something which I am allowed to do under UK copyright law. Please, can you investigate? Secretary of State is then obliged to investigate. And if the Secretary of State decides, in his or her infinite wisdom, that yes, indeed, this blockage is deliberate and is unjustified, can issue a statement telling the company lower the barrier. But then if the company refuses to lower the barrier, it's up to the individual to sue the company. So the whole process is slow and convoluted. And I personally would like to see a change in the law that if a barrier is introduced, it should be an offence. Full stop. None of this appealing to the Secretary of State, the Secretary of State expresses an opinion. Just it is so they can be prosecuted.
It should be called the Oppenhein law.
Yes, I would find it. If that's my...
no conflict of interest whatsoever.
Yeah. No. Yeah. Okay, all in favour of that. That would make me a very happy man.
From a practical point of view, it's not easy to do. Because it can only be put in the same pipeline, same access route as legitimate use.
And so we could probably slow everybody. And there's a reputational thing again, you know, this company is stopping people doing.
So, for example, and this is recorded factually, by pure happenstance, the American Chemical Society's webpage got triggered on a spider trap, right?
I remember this.
Yes.
And as a result, it spread throughout the community. And 200 sites were cut off automatically.
Because it's easy to click on it, and then
And it got closed down. And that disadvantaged all the users. You know, my colleagues in chemistry were upset with the American Chemical Society for cutting off the.
Understandably.
Would it be fair to say that the spider ended up biting its own ass?
Not on air, I don't think that. Jenny, you've just arrived, and we're having a having a conversation.
Oh, you're coming in.
Sit with Steve, not be tent on
you.
We're having a conversation with Yvonne and Charles about libraries and the new hard groups.
Just ask some questions from because I'm very aware of the wider library community. People, they may know the exemption of them.
I'm just wondering whether
Jenny, we are on there.
Yes.
Whether if you could think of a vehicle whereby I could say write an article. But what would be the best place here to be put for a large proportion of UK academic would read it?
That's interesting. Some of this a bit arbitrary.
Absolutely.
And I've read it for Stuart.
But do you see an art group? Is that, does that have a newsletter or?
I'm not sure. Does
our UK have a newsletter? They well do.
It must have distribution.
Yeah, that's good.
RLUK do the most of stuff online as opposed to, I don't know, they might do it too.
They might just have a guest blog or something
right.
Like that.
Well,
if we communicate after the event, and
because I know they have a blog, most recent thing they had on it was to but I know from my team library that's actually really respectful sense to put. And they do lots of library mailing lists as well, which cover the general library mailing lists.
Of course, yes. if the blog, say, the RL UK, and just gave the URL on other lists.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
Yeah. Yeah.
I need a lawyer. Oh, hello. Good.
But it does worry me if you said that at the start. Librarians either don't understand or are very nervous.
I think they're nervous. When you're outside their own, I think the Cambridge you've seen an exception anyway because you're working with your journalists. So to us, we're used to stepping on and those people aren't. So we're in a position of having some knowledge, but other people aren't in that position. Yeah. So they know these initiatives are coming. But I know academics don't know about it, but they're not skilled. They just haven't got the skill set. Obviously, there's like that management skill set has changed the whole time. So you have people who are doing multiple copyright law, but even so, this is a new departure.
It's a new departure, and the implications.
Again, really back to on chapter one.
Yeah.
It is,
really.
I think that's a major issue.
In a good way, but also in a complex way.
Well, one of the dangers, I think, of the fact that it's not widely known is that people may carry out actions which are then seen as questionable.
Yes.
Yeah.
And that worries me. So, for example, about 3 years ago, Heather Pivoir in the University, wanted to do text and data mining, and she negotiated with Elsevier.
Yeah.
That was long and protracted. It put her under a great deal of stress, which she admitted publicly. And as a result, there was a specific agreement with the University of British Columbia for her to carry out certain projects. And that's the way it's been up to now. It may be that some people will continue that way. And what worries me is that we will then have the position where publishers will say, libraries actually don't want this. They prefer to negotiate with us directly, or researchers don't really want it, and so forth. And it's used as a way to show that this is not important, that nothing needs to change, and so forth.
That's why in the UK we have an advantage, namely GIST and GIST Collection, who can negotiate on behalf of the community.
Yeah.
And they're certainly aware of the change in the law, and hopefully will be much more robust with their future negotiations with publishers. To ensure that the contract, in fact, the current standard GISC contract is okay because one of the clauses say nothing. It literally says it says nothing in this contract shall prevent somebody doing, a user from doing things which are permitted in law.
Okay, so
it's already embedded. Irrespective of the fact that such clauses preventing GDM are not valid, we're already covered with most of the GISC standard contracts. And that's an important clause to have whenever you sign a deal, is to have that embedded.
And also for those listening in, ContentMine and GISC ran a joint workshop in December last year, so just about a month ago, with a very good attendance from GISC staff, and these issues were discussed, and so there's great knowledge in GISC about both the politics, legal, and technical aspects of text and data mining.
GISC, I'm not sure if that works. And I'm not sure that it's just legal that I would have anything on it.
But we can certainly talk to new vacancy organizers.
Oh, absolutely. I get it.
Yeah. I mean, we do need to follow up through them. It's quite a few people said that they wanted to be kept up to date. We
yes.
Have these people yeah, yeah, yeah. And just
to give us some of the work that you mentioned.
Yes.
Yeah. Yeah. It's a good question.
It's going to find out. Yes. I think, I mean, one of the things is that the visibility is still so low. And then the librarians won't get it. You get the inquiries because the researchers don't know they can do it either. And it can't be
really just yeah. I mean, at the moment, I think. The likely things that will happen is, first of all, I think many researchers will not know anything's changed, so they yes. will either they will continue to do what they've been doing, which is either carrying out mining activity without actually alerting anybody to it, or they will believe that it's so difficult or it's
yeah.
illegal or
whatever.
They're scared.
Yeah. 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 It just could be feedback to just the have to just think of the change because that's not my social media, but if you search it just for TDM, there's nothing. If you search it for text data, there's like 33 things that come up. But
right.
I didn't get a chance.
Okay, well,
but there's information there, yeah. The most recent is the value and benefits.
Oh, yeah, because a lot of those hits would be that report.
Yeah. Oh, yes, of course, they did
so,
the report, yeah.
Yeah.
That's like,
but it would be useful to know if they put anything in.
Yeah. Yeah. Absolutely, absolutely. Well, a couple of years ago,
it was about that, and that highlighted that you know, the reuse of data in biomedical was of the order of Europe of 125 billion a year or something of that sort. It wasn't just text and data.
No. But they said there was lots of potential.
Yes.
So what was the commission
they hated the
they
had
I wonder
asked.
Why.
They were furious about it. When Hargreaves originally started his research for the report, don't think text and data mining particularly came up. But when he wrote, when he published the report, there it was. At that point, the publishers were furious. It basically said, this is the end of civilization, we know it. But the government, bless its cotton sock, stuck with it and introduced the change to the law. That's possible, that extra clause about you mustn't do anything which degrades the quality of the service which a supplier gets, might have got introduced as a result of partnership pressure. But yes, and now it's been proposed that this should be extended to the EU, and
yeah.
Publisher reaction to that has been
furious. Everything, so everything back to just the report was updated on 15th of January.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
But I haven't had a chance to actually see
yeah.
whether it was a full stop or something.
So, Yvonne, from our point of view in ContentMine, we have now got, post-alpha versions of the technology, right? And that's what we're doing at the Hackday. Yeah. With the result that one of our future activities in the near future will be to mine the literature on a regular basis, probably daily, and to extract facts from that using our automated software and to make the facts which are not copyrightable available under a permissive license such as CC0. So that's alerting you to the fact that that's going to be done, and that will be done because we believe it to be completely legal in the UK. A positive side of this is that people who want to do research, which depends on that, as far as I'm concerned, are more than welcome to collaborate with us on research projects. And so if people like Jenny, who's a member of Cambridge University, or me, or Richard or Steph find that somebody wants to work on something which is mutually interesting, then I'd be very happy to put my own effort into it. So that again makes it completely new. And one of the things that the UK IPO was very keen on, Intellectual Property Office, was that this should be seen to have positive benefits.
Yeah.
And so that if we can show that people want to come to Cambridge to do research, because it's the world centre for content mining, then I think the IPO, government.uk, would feel that that was a partial success of the new model.
Yeah. And also, from what I understand, the financial benefits to society at large of TDM are massive.
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
In a positive sense.
Yeah.
The conundrum for us is that we cannot use this material for our own commercial benefit. And we. And so we have to be clear that what we publish, other people can make money out of it.
But that is helpful. Well, helpful in the way that it ensures you're not going to break the law, but it's unhelpful in the sense of, well, how is ContentMine going to continue in the longer term?
And also, how's it going to show an economic benefit?
How's it going to show an economic benefit?
UK.
Yeah.
I've got another question. So,
what
about public accessible food data sets?
Yeah. Oh, that's fine anyway.
Or is that fine? I want to check. I mean, just because something's publicly accessible.
Well, it depends under what license it's available. We did skim over this morning, and we're skimming over this afternoon the question of database, like, which is a separate one. And the crucial problem with database rights is that this exception does not apply to database.
Right.
Where a database enjoys database rights. And actually, not that many do, but some databases enjoy database rights. Unfortunately, you have to negotiate with the owner in order to do it.
There's lots of databases and repositories or data sets
that are
interesting. Absolutely.
But that's true of everything Creative Commons, you know, that people who can take advantage of Creative Commons materials and make money out of it if they so wish. Yes.
Does that give you an idea, Yvonne, as to where we're going?
Yeah, definitely.
Some of what we're doing will be done from outside the paywall, so that really shouldn't concern anybody, because it could be done by anybody in the UK.
At any time, yes.
Anybody in the UK can point their machine at publishers' free-to-view websites and mine it for facts and republish the facts, and that will break any of the existing laws. Going behind the paywall requires somebody who has a right do it, which includes half the people in this room and excludes half the people in this room.
If you've got lawful access, and if you have lawful access as a member of Kent University, and Kent University has got a license to that material.
And then.
I mean,
it's
nothing in the
And then all.
If I go to natural history as a business owner, with special view and with their own terms and conditions for access, I sell them as a special business owner. Am I bound by
Then you might be. You might be bound by their terms and conditions in terms of we grant you access under the following conditions. And I mean, just for example, if you were to go to the Natural History Museum to inspect their copy of Audubon's Bird, and you photocopied every page and walked off with it, if they, and even though it's out of copyright, they would be able to say, hang on, that's against our rules, assuming it is against their rules.
if you've damaged the book and slandered on the protocol or whatever else it might be. So they're entitled to impose their extra rules.
But I would only have a problem with them publishing the technical.
Yes, exactly. Correct. Absolutely right. Yeah.
So I was in the
BA
the other day, actually, and they've got somebody saying, I want to photograph books.
Yeah, yeah, absolutely. Yeah. But they're entitled to impose whatever condition they like.
And of course, Ross, they might not let you back.
Yes.
Which is another factor, yes. So, if I were you, I'd stick to that.
So, Yvonne, one of the things that we are very keen to do is to make our tools and services and training available to libraries. I mean, you've highlighted that this is a problem, that not everybody in libraries is aware of what is possible and the details of it. So we've now proofed our training courses, and they've been delivered to a considerable number of different types of organisations. So we're just saying to you and to the world that we'd be very happy to come in and run anything from probably a 2-hour workshop to a 2-day workshop.
Actually, let us trigger off another call, in addition to possibly writing articles, presentations, UKSG or something like that.
And
do they have special...
Yeah,
because UKSG... A few case serials.
I know, I presented 2 years ago.
Oh, right, okay.
Because that was in one of their points, because he presented.
It generated some discussion.
Yeah, I think
I don't know whether, but presumably the program is already set. Yeah, but they normally have parallel sessions with.
And I
also
think that is very
interesting. I'm sure, absolutely.
I mean, it was not bad when I went. One of the bad things about these conferences is you often get product clubs.
Oh, yeah.
But you do that, okay.
Yeah. That would keep you too many. Let's see, it's too expensive. I've only ever been as a freebie, because I've been a speaker, so I've no idea how much it costs. Is that including accommodation?
No.
Oh, it's really expensive.
Is that interesting?
Well, yes, people are, sort of all seated. There's lots of manufacturers, and vendors there and so on.
Yeah.
I only go for an invite.
Yeah.